I hope you remember the differential equation example that we had, right? Essentially, what we were trying to do was some numerical integration of some second order differential equation. So this was what we had, right? The C code equivalent of solving this, we started off with this equation that needs to be integrated. Then we went through the C code equivalent, right? And slowly went through constructing this entire data flow graph. Okay. Now, that is precisely what I'm trying to implement over here. Okay. If we go back and look at this, we'll see that the code, in fact, that I had over there, I wrote a while loop, right? The only difference over here is that I've written it as a for loop. Okay. Because I'm basically saying x1 less than a. It doesn't really matter at all. I mean, the x1 plus equal to dx could just as well have been brought down here. This is not strictly speaking correct. In fact, I have got an error in this code. I'm doing addition twice. I've got a for loop over here where I do the plus, and I've also got this plus being done over here. Okay, so I can probably just comment this out. But logically, you can see that this is exactly the same code as what I have over here. Okay, it does this x1, u1, y1. And then basically it updates those three values, okay? And just like we had over here, we had C1, C2 constants. Here, once again, I have C1, C2. What I'm doing is I'm getting all of those as inputs from outside, okay? This is the equivalent of basically saying that as far as this system is concerned, all of these C1, X, U, DX, etc., all of them are inputs that are coming in for that particular iteration, okay? And this entire thing that I'm trying to sort of code up over here, right, this task graph, dependency graph, essentially corresponds to what is there inside the body of the for loop or the while loop, okay, all the operations, right? And the question then becomes, what happens when we try and synthesize something like this? Okay. So, as you can see over here, this is a considerably more complicated piece of code, right? It's not a simple single multiplication. So it's quite clear that I can't do everything within a single clock cycle. Okay. And the question then becomes, what can I actually do with it? How would I convert this into hardware? Okay. So let's just go through with the synthesis process. So we can, basically take a look at what it has synthesized into. Now let's look at these results and try and understand it, right? The target clock period that I had given was 8 nanoseconds. It was able to meet that, okay, 6.8 something, right? And one thing you will notice now is that suddenly this latency and interval, instead of showing numbers over there, it is showing question marks. So why question marks? Basically what it's saying is, it is unable to infer how long one function call, right? One time if I call this diffic function, how many clock cycles will it take to finish? And of course, the reason why it is not able to find that out is because how many clock cycles it will take to finish depends on the value of dx and it depends on the value of a, right? So the number of times that this for loop runs is definitely going to be dependent on the value of dx and a, right? Therefore, at compile time, when I'm doing the synthesis, I don't know how many times it's going to run. Okay. But now let's look a little bit closer over here. It does give me some useful information though, which is to say that there is a loop inside this module, right? This thing that I'm designing, right? So how does Vivado HLS work? It basically tries and makes every function call that you have, or rather the top level function call that you have, it tries and converts that into a Verilog module. Okay. Now, inside that Verilog module, if there are blocks of code, in particular, if there are other function calls, or if there are loops that need to happen in a certain way, or in general, other blocks of such code, it will treat those also, in some cases, as Verilog modules that need to get synthesized separately. Okay. Not always, whether it treats them as separate Verilog modules or whether it just treats them as part of the same module, depends on a few other kinds of optimizations that it needs to do, but if necessary, it can do that. Okay. Now, in this particular case, what has happened is it has identified that there is a loop, and the loop label that I have given here is L1. Okay. So it says there is a loop called L1. Latency I don't know what it is, question marks. But the initiation interval, on the other hand, it says is 5. Okay, so what does that mean? It basically says that for running through this entire loop once, it will go, take this system 5 clock cycles. Okay, what is this trip count that it mentions over here? That essentially refers to how many times does this loop run, which, like I told you, depends on A as well as BX. Okay, so the trip count is unknown, therefore the latency is unknown, but each individual iteration will take 5 clock cycles. Okay, remember in this entire, you know, example of scheduling that we had over here, right, we went through this process and tried to find critical path depending on the delay of multiplier, adder, etc. You can find out what the overall latency is going to be. Okay, so clearly this number 5 that it has come up with is in some way related to that. How is it related is something that we need to find out further. Okay, now let's look at the hardware resource usage. First thing you can see is no block RAMs. Understandable, because there are no arrays, no memory being used anywhere in this design. What about DSP slices? It says 18. Does that make sense? Does that fit with what you expect? Okay. So to understand that, look at the code, right? What do we have? We have one multiplication here, one here, one here, C2, Y into DX and U into DX. Okay. So there are 6 multiplications. And from the earlier example, we already saw that if I'm trying to multiply two 32-bit integers together, I need 3 DSP slices. So 3 into 6, 18 DSP slices makes perfect sense. Right? What about the rest of it? Why are there 990 DSP48s or rather flip-flops being used? 990 for instance, plus another 390 for registers. This part is not so clear, right? And in general, these are always the harder parts, right? The number of flip-flops and number of lookup tables, it is always difficult to get good justifications for why they are what they are, okay, for the exact numbers. What we can do is go to this button on the top right-hand side called analysis. And if I click on that, now it starts showing me a little bit more detail, right? Now, what does this chart over here show? Essentially, what it's saying is the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are what are called control steps. Okay? They essentially correspond to these steps that we have over here, right? So, for example, in this ASAP schedule picture that I have, 0, 1, 2, 3 are the control steps. They are also time steps. So why call it something fancy like control step? The reason for that is because you can sometimes have a situation where you are trying to schedule a large graph, a large function, which in turn has smaller functions inside it, right? And if that smaller function, let's say, takes 100 clock cycles, as far as the outer function is concerned, you don't care. It is still one control step because I give control to the smaller function and then 100 cycles later, I get back control from it. Okay, so that is where control steps become important. Over here for us, for all practical purposes, one control step equals one clock cycle. Okay, let's try and understand what is happening out here. You can see that, you know, what are the operations that happen? There is a C1 read and a DX read. Okay, now both of this, the C1 into DX is actually happening somewhere. If you look at it, it is happening before this loop starts. Okay, so in other words, it looks as though what this code, this compiler has done is it has taken the C1 into DX, realized that both of these, or rather C1 is a constant, right? Which means that I can do the C1 into DX ahead of time, right? And it need not be done inside the loop. Okay, one small optimization that it has performed over there. Okay, so that multiplication it does. What do you do with that multiplication? It will be used somewhere inside the loop. So I give it a variable name called temp1 and keep it ready. After that, it needs to read C2, U0, Y0, X0, where and A, okay? Where are all of these coming from? They are the inputs of the function, okay? And then I get into the loop, L1. I can click on this arrow and expand what L1 actually looks like, right? And you will find that there are a whole lot of, you know, variables declared and so on over here. Rather than trying to understand every single one of them, what I'm going to do is try and, you know, look at, can we get a broad picture for what are the operations that are actually happening, right? You'll notice that there are all of these things happening out here, these sort of big operations. And when you look at this column over here, you'll see that each of them is a multiplication, right? So there is a temp 2, okay, which is a multiplication, then temp 3 is also a multiplication, and so on. On the bottom part of the panel, it actually shows you, in fact, which line number this code corresponds to. So temp 3 corresponds to line 18, right? And line 18 is the U computation, this one over here. Unfortunately, the way that I've written it, all the computations, you know, 5 of the multiplications are on one line, right? Which means that you will find that temp 2, temp 3, temp 7 actually corresponds to the next, but temp underscore 3, temp underscore 5, all of them correspond to the same multiplication, the same line. And in fact, so does temp 1, right? When you look at this, you'll also realize that, you know, Vivado HLS, I mean, couldn't you think of better ways of naming variables? Because after all, why should you have temp 3 as one variable and temp underscore 3 as another variable? This is clearly, you know, this code is not meant to be read by human beings, right? Otherwise, I mean, this is just a recipe for confusion. Unfortunately, there are situations where you actually do need to read it, right? And in such a situation, it's not clear why they had to choose names like this. Okay. So, but let's look at it. What is happening is 3 multiplications, another 2 multiplications out here, a final addition, and there is this green arrow out here, right, which is sort of going back from this last operation all the way till something out here. Okay. What is that happening? Look at it. This green arrow is essentially saying, is precisely talking about this green arrow, which is the UL update. Okay. It's basically saying I have computed U1, and now I need to basically take it and feed it back into U. Okay. How is that happening? If I look at it, this U1 computation is basically a subtraction. Where is it getting its inputs from? Look at the 2 blue curved arrows coming in here. One of them is coming from temp underscore 3. The other input to this is coming from this line, which is temp underscore 6, which in turn is also a subtractor. Okay. Go back and look at this. Yes, this last subtractor is in turn getting an input from a subtractor. The other input is coming from U. So what is U in turn? That is basically coming from all the other multiplications that need to be done over there, right? So it needs to get this C1 into X into U into DX needs to get multiplied. How does that happen? There is one multiplication here, which in turn is getting its inputs from one multiplication. Well, the C multiplication happens somewhere else. It then takes it from this other multiplication, temp 3. Okay. So if you work through this, right, you will see that every one of these multiplications has an equivalent in the scheduled viewer. Okay, you can sort of pinpoint exactly which corresponds to what, except that some things might get slightly changed. So for example, you know this original instruction out here, the C1 into DX. In the original code, the C1 into DX is happening somewhere inside line 18, right? In fact, if you look at it, it is not even doing C1 into DX. It's doing C1 into X into U into DX, right? So why did this compiler decide to do C1 into DX first over here? That is some kind of a compilation optimization. It needs to do it, but it need not do it inside the hardware or inside the loop. Why not do it outside once and for all and compute C1 into DX and keep it ready for further computation? Okay, that is the way that this process is working. What you can see over here is, you know, a number of things. So for example, one of the things that you can notice is these multipliers are not pipelined. Okay, because a multiplication needs to finish, and only after the multiplication finishes, the next one starts, right? So even though this multiplication temp 2 and this temp underscore 5 don't have any direct dependencies, it doesn't sort of put them one after the other, or rather it doesn't sort of start them in the next clock cycle. It waits until it finishes before it can then move on. Okay, but if you look closely at this, remember the hardware utilization estimate, it said that it was actually physically using 6 multipliers. What that means is that this actual hardware schedule that has been created, even though it is showing you all of this and you know there is no dependency, or rather there is no overlap between multiplications and so on, it has just decided to go ahead and put in 6 different multipliers to implement the hardware. Okay, that is why you end up with this kind of a synthesis result. Why did it do that? Well, you did not really tell it to optimize. That's not a good answer, but on the other hand, that's the bottom line. That's basically why it has not tried to reduce the number of hardware multipliers. What you can do, right, we need to go back to the synthesis tab over here. Now you will understand why this hash pragma line is over here. Okay, hash pragma is basically, it's a C++ construct. So the hash pragma by itself is something that is part of C++. It is not really part of Vivado HLS. But on the other hand, Vivado HLS has generated a bunch of pragmas of its own, all of which start with this word HLS. Okay, now a pragma is a sort of directive to the C compiler, right? Telling it that it should process something about the code in a certain way, right? It's not really like a hash include. Hash includes are only used in order to define certain parameters and to include header files and so on. Instead of that, a hash pragma actually directly tells the compiler to modify its behavior in some way. Okay, Vivado HLS extensively uses these hash pragmas. They are called directives in order to control how the hardware gets synthesized. Okay, in this particular case, this is one example of a directive that can be used. What we can do is I can say allocation for multipliers, right? And mul is basically a sort of a predefined keyword in Vivado HLS. It says all multiplication related operations. And what we are saying is limit equal to 1 for multiply operations. What do you think is likely to happen as a result of this? If I look at the schedule right now, I have a situation where, you know, these 3 multipliers, for example, are happening in parallel with each other. Similarly, these 2 are happening in parallel. If I enforce saying only 1 multiplier can be used, right, and I go ahead and synthesize this once again, I will see that it has some kind of an impact on the final output, right? What impact does it have? You can see that the number of DSP slices came down to 3, right? So in other words, it has actually obeyed our directive and used only 1 DSP slice. The number of flip-flops actually, interestingly, in this case came down, right? So clearly the previous design was not very efficient. It was not only using a large number of DSP slices, it was also using a large number of flip-flops, probably more than required. But if I go look at the analysis, now look at how things have changed, right? Essentially, what I have is, now you see that the multipliers, right, even though I'm using only 1 hardware multiplier, it is now using the multiplication multipliers in a pipeline fashion, right? So this temp2, which is basically taking x into y, right? So temp2 is basically computing x into u, okay? So if you go back and look at these lines, right, you can see that x into u is being computed by temp2, okay, whereas the next one is basically doing y into something up there, dx, y into dx. Okay, now this multiplication, temp2 and temp3, if you look at where they are getting their inputs from, you can clearly see that they are independent of each other. In other words, I don't need the output of temp2 in order to compute temp3, right? Perfect situation for pipelining. What it does is, it starts temp2 over here. It's going to take 2 clock cycles to finish temp2. In the meantime, after 1 clock cycle, it starts temp3. Then it starts temp_7, right? Then it starts this next one, which is temp_3, and so on. So in other words, the multiplication operations are completely pipelined, right? It was always able to find in the next clock cycle some other multiplication that did not depend on what I just started now, right? What happens to the overall latency? Now these five multiplications, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 clock cycles are there. A sixth clock cycle in order to finish that multiplication, and the operation, the output of that multiplication is in turn used in the seventh clock cycle to actually do the U update. Okay, so the overall latency for L1, the loop, now becomes 7 clock cycles instead of the 5 that it was earlier. Okay, what else can you do? You can change the solution settings so that instead of having 8 nanoseconds, let's say that I, you know, give it a really relaxed constraint, 50 nanoseconds, right? A very slow 20 megahertz clock, you know, 20 megahertz clock period. Okay, what happens if I synthesize with this? Now you will notice that it actually takes an estimated 12.9 or 13 nanoseconds. So still, no, in other words, if I give it essentially infinite time, it's still not able to use it. It still requires only around 13 nanoseconds per clock cycle. What happens to the analysis? Now you see that, you know, even these multiplications are taking a small part of my clock cycle. Each multiply delay out here is 8.47 nanoseconds, right? Which is a small part of 50, right? What it does is, unfortunately, because of the way that the computations are being done, it needs, and the fact that I have only one multiplier hardware, right, it ends up putting all of them one after the other. So each multiplication happens in one clock cycle. I still need to end up taking 5 clock cycles. The interesting thing is, you'll notice that this last multiplication, its output is used by an adder, right? Remember that that adder was done in the next clock cycle. Here, I have put both the multiplication as well as the addition into a single clock cycle. Okay, and this is something called operation chaining, where essentially what it does is it takes multiple operations, one depends on the previous, one depends on another, and puts them into the same clock cycle. Okay, all of those can be done by this scheduling tool. Okay, so if you think about what is happening behind the scenes, the compiler first took this function and converted it into a task graph, very similar to this, okay, the data flow graph. And after that, some kind of scheduling operations are being done. Because I have a resource constraint in this case saying only one instance of multiplication is permitted, the scheduler then has to go ahead and, you know, figure out how to do them one after the other. But other operations like addition and so on, it tries and packs them into the same clock cycle as far as possible. Okay, so hopefully this gives you a flavor for how Vivado HLS actually takes a regular C code and converts it into something that can basically into hardware, right? And also the fact that, you know, the all the algorithms, the scheduling and so on that we looked at all this while, can be used in this context because of the way that this system is set up. First convert it into a task, the data flow graph, do the scheduling, figure out what operations can fit where, make sure that resource constraints, etc., are satisfied, and finally, you know, it can generate, finally it can output a Verilog code that basically realizes this schedule. That Verilog code, you can take a look at it. It's going to be hard to understand, you know that upfront, because, you know, it's definitely going to have multiple state machines, lots of temporary variables. If you really dig through it, you can sort of make out what is happening when, but for the most part, you are much better off with this analysis view that you have over here.